Hi, everybody, and welcome to Ewe University. I'm Dr. Kelly. It's a lovely day here in Illinois. I have the windows open, so there's a nice breeze coming in. We are having a very early spring this year. Everything is turning green, and the lilacs are getting ready to bloom. The temperature's been warming up, and we've had some beautiful days this week. We are about a month early with the leaves coming out on the trees. That doesn't usually happen until May. Now you might notice that I don't have any flowers today, and that is my cat's fault. I probably would have still had my roses from last week, but a couple of days after I recorded my last video, when I got up in the morning, and my craft room where I record is right across the hall from my bedroom. Well, I looked across the hall into this room, and there were my flowers knocked all over the floor. The vase was on the floor with water spilled everywhere. And the culprit is my 13-year-old black cat. When he was younger, he would always get into plants or cut flowers that I had in the house. Even if I had them up on the counter or the kitchen table, and he knows he's not supposed to be up on the kitchen counters or the table, but at night, after we would go to bed, he would get up there and chew on the flowers and usually knock the whole thing over. So I had gotten to where I wasn't buying plants or flowers for the house for a long time because he would just wreck them. But now that he's old, he can't jump up on the counters anymore, and I've been able to bring flowers into the house again. Now, I haven't had any incidents with him at all getting into the cut flowers that I've had until this past week. I don't know if it was because the roses smelled so good compared to all the other flowers that I've had, but he apparently jumped up on my table here, or maybe he just reached up, you know, with his paws from the floor and was biting at the flowers and knocked them over. So that was the end of my roses, and I haven't gotten over to the flower shop to get anything else. But this week I did get something new and exciting, and that is a Cricut loom, which is a small tabletop loom made by the Schacht Company. I haven't finished putting it together yet, but here it is. There's a bunch more pieces that need to be included, so I'll be doing that this week. This loom is 15 inches wide, and with it you can make things like scarves, pot holders, placemats, you know, smaller items. Once I get it all assembled, I'll be trying my hand at weaving. In fact, my friend Gail and I went to the local Weavers Guild meeting this week, and they were really interested in my little loom. And those ladies were so nice. One of them lent me this book of patterns for woven scarves. And I'm really enamored with several of the patterns in here. So yeah, once I get more experience with weaving and more familiar with the features of my loom, I will definitely be showing it to you and talking about it in a future video. In fact, I have several ideas for different videos about weaving, so keep an eye out for those upcoming episodes. Now, as far as knitting, I'm going to tell you right now that I haven't made much progress on my knee socks that I'm currently making. I'm not going to devote a whole segment to just showing that I've knit, you know, a couple of inches on the foot. I didn't have much knitting time this past week. I've been getting ready for a conference, a psychology research conference that's coming up in a few days. So that's been taking up a lot of my time. Hopefully I will finish the socks this week, given that I should have quite a bit of knitting time on the train and probably in my hotel room. I will definitely give you an update next time. Today I'm going to show you one of my favorite gadgets, and that is a little digital pocket scale. Mini scales like this are so useful for weighing your leftover yarn and calculating how much yardage you have left. So for example, if you started with a project with 100 grams of sock yarn and the original yardage was 400 yards, if you have 20 grams left over, that is 20% of what you started with, which equates to 80 yards. So the formula is weight of leftover yarn divided by weight of original yarn times original yardage equals remaining yardage. Another use for these little scales is if you are making mini skeins and say you want 20 gram mini skeins or 10 gram mini skeins. You can just make little balls of yarn and weigh them until you get the amount you want. So these little things are super handy. This is a little pocket scale I got on Amazon for less than $10. It has a 200 gram capacity. This silver rectangle is the weighing surface, and then down here it has the display screen and buttons. It has an on-off switch in the middle here, and the display is backlit so it's easy to see. You can also change the units of measurement from grams to ounces, which is the button on the right. The button on the left resets the measurement to zero for easy manual calibration. I also love that it has a flip open lid to protect the weighing surface. It's battery operated, and the battery is easy to change by sliding open this panel on the back. A battery is also included when you buy the scale. So I'll put a link below to this particular pocket scale, but there are tons of other ones that you can find. The ones that I've seen are all under something like $7 to $10, so they're very affordable. I'd actually like to get a couple more to keep them in different Notions pouches. So again, that is the little pocket digital scale, which is really handy to use for weighing your yarn. So do you have a little scale like this? Do you keep one in your project bag to keep track of your yardage? Or maybe you have some other things that you use it for? Let me know by commenting below. I would love to hear from you. A few weeks ago, I finished listening to an audiobook of the novel Sapphire Skies by Belinda Alexandra. This book sounded intriguing to me because it was about a female Russian fighter pilot. I'm kind of trying to avoid the World War II time period in general in books that I read because I feel like I've read so many books in that time frame. But I found out that this story was inspired by a real person named Lydia Litviak. And of course, when a novel is based on real history, that usually sucks me in. And in this work of historical fiction, I learned quite a bit. The real Lydia Litviak was an ace pilot in the Soviet Air Force, and she was enamored with the iconic women in movies. She defied regulations by always wearing makeup and perfume and styling her hair, even when she flew on missions during the war. She was an extremely skilled pilot, as well as a beautiful woman. Lydia shot down a record number of enemy planes by herself and was only 21 years old when her plane was shot down during a battle. Her body was not immediately recovered, and this led to all sorts of speculation that she was a German spy, that she'd been seen in a concentration camp, or that she had escaped to Switzerland where she started a new life. Her body was reportedly discovered in the late 1970s, but there is some controversy as to whether this was really Lydia or not. No one really knows what happened to her, if that was really her body, or if she might have survived and maybe is even still alive today. This whole intriguing story provided the impetus for the novel Sapphire Skies. So back to the novel. This book opens in the modern day with the recovery of a Soviet fighter plane that crashed in the Ukraine during World War II. It was one of the planes flown by the female Russian pilots who so skillfully attacked their German enemies, and the German pilots called them night witches. It is revealed that this plane belongs to an ace fighter pilot named Natalia Azarova. She was suspected of defecting to Germany after being shot down. Soon we are crossing time between the war and the present day with detailed portraits of Stalin's Russia and Putin's Russia. We have two incredible heroines, the modern day Lily and the historical Natalia. Lily is recovering from a tragic loss, but has a remarkable compassion for others. She helps a perfect stranger, an elderly woman whom she meets in a train station. The historical story is about Natalia, how she grows up and becomes a fighter pilot. And through her eyes, we see what everyday life was like during Stalin's administration. The fear, the arrest, the paranoia, the backstabbing, the scarcity of food and supplies. As the story unfolds, Natalia's history intertwines with Lily's life in curious ways. There is never a dull moment in this book, and I learned a lot about Russian history, the Siberian work camps, and Stalin himself. The aviation scenes are well done and gripping, although there are not a lot of them. The novel flows seamlessly back and forth from past to present and alternates points of view impeccably. The writing transports you to another time and place. Now, the author, Belinda Alexandra, knows her subject matter intimately. Her parents escaped Russia after the revolution and eventually settled in Australia. She writes with passion and creates characters that linger with you long after you finish the book. And I think what I love the most about this book is that the story of Natalia is based on Lydia Litviak's real life. So I gave this book 5 stars, and the reader, Carolyn Lee, she was really good too. She is the first Australian reader that I've heard on Audible, which was perfect for this book since the story's modern day heroine, Lily, was from Australia. So she gets 5 stars as well. And again, that is the audiobook Sapphire Skies by Belinda Alexandra. Today's topic is all about silk. And I thought I would give you a little background on the history of silk, its production, the different types, and the properties of silk yarn and textiles. So here we go. Silk is a continuous strand of 2 filaments cemented together, which forms the cocoon of the silkworm. The silkworm secretes silk by forcing 2 fine streams of thick liquid out tiny openings in its head. On contact with the air, the fine streams of liquid harden into filaments. The worm winds the silk around itself, forming a cocoon, which is a complete covering for protection while it changes from a worm into a moth. As much as a mile's length of fiber is used to make the cocoon. Silk is said to have been discovered over 4,500 years ago by a Chinese empress. According to Chinese legend, the young empress Zi Ling Shi was sitting in her garden underneath a mulberry tree drinking tea when a silkworm cocoon fell into her cup. As she watched it dissolve, she saw that the cocoon was made out of 1 long translucent thread. Wondering if this thread could be used to make fabric, Zi Ling Shi studied it. She could see that the thread was bright and resistant. She also noticed that a worm was concealed within the cocoon, and she recognized it as the kind of worm that ate the leaves of the mulberry tree growing in her garden. Now, instead of getting rid of those worms, she asked her husband permission to plant more mulberry trees where she could grow silkworms. What resulted was sericulture, the science of farming silkworms and producing silk. Zi Ling Shi became the first sericulturist and is also credited with inventing the loom. She taught other women how to weave the fibers from the silkworm's cocoons. These discoveries and inventions were so important that Zi Ling Shi became a Chinese deity and is called Silkworm Mother. Now, no one knows exactly how much of this story is actually true, but it is corroborated by some anthropological evidence. In 1927, a partial silkworm cocoon was unearthed from the banks of the Yellow River in northern China, and it dates back to between 2300 and 2600 BC. Other silk ribbons, threads, and woven fabric fragments have been found and dated to about 3000 BC. More recent discoveries include a small ivory cup carved with a silkworm design, which is thought to be around 6,000 to 7,000 years old. But the oldest evidence of silk has been found in ancient tombs in China, which shows that people used silk thousands of years earlier than was previously thought. The location of these tombs has climate and soil that are excellent for growing mulberry trees, whose leaves are the sole food of silkworms. Chemical analyses in the tombs unveiled evidence of silk proteins in two of the tombs, one of which dated back nearly 9,000 years. This latest evidence places silk use far earlier than the legends of Ziling Shi. But regardless of when it was first discovered, the evidence points to silk being reserved exclusively for the use of royalty. Within the palace, the emperor wore a robe of white silk, and outside of the palace, he wore yellow silk to represent the earth. For thousands of years, the people of China closely guarded the secret of how silk was produced. This secret was punishable by death for anyone who might dare to spill it. This was possibly the most zealously guarded and longest kept secret in history. So China had a monopoly on silk production for many, many years. Gradually, people of various classes in society began wearing tunics of silk, and silk came into more general use. It was eventually put into industrial use, becoming one of the principal elements of Chinese economy. Silk was used to make stringed instruments, fishing line, bowstrings, and even the world's first luxury paper. At some point, even commoners were able to wear silk garments. Now, during the Han Dynasty, around 2,000 years ago, silk ceased to be used as an industrial material and became a form of currency. People paid their taxes in grain and silk. Silk was used to pay employees and to reward people for outstanding services. Currency values were calculated in lengths of silk, similar to how gold's value is measured in weight. Before long, silk currency was used in trade with foreign countries. It became a precious commodity, highly sought by other countries. An Egyptian mummy dating to 3,000 years ago is the earliest evidence of the silk trade. Many of the Chinese emperor's ambassadors traveled west bearing gifts, including silks. In time, Chinese silks became widely worn by the noble families of Rome. The craving for silk continued to increase over the centuries. The best Chinese silk cost as much as a Roman soldier's salary for an entire year. Sometime around the year 1015, a group of Buddhist monks sealed more than 10,000 silk paintings, banners, and textiles in a cave, which was not discovered again for 900 years. And what a treasure! But still, the West knew very little about silk. In fact, one Roman historian speculated that silk was a downy substance that came from trees. Sericulture reached Korea around 200 BC when Chinese immigrants arrived there. Silkworm cultivation was established in India about 500 years later. And around 550 AD, two missionaries arrived at the Byzantine emperor's court with silkworm eggs and mulberry seeds that they had smuggled out of China. They showed the locals how to hatch the eggs into worms and then watched as the worms spun cocoons. This represented the establishment of the silk industry in the Middle East, from where it became widespread in Europe. So, what was the secret of sericulture? Well, there are many varieties of wild silk moths found in a number of different countries, but only one species is key to understanding the great mystery and magic of silk, as well as China's domination of silk production, and that is the Bombyx mori, which means moth of the mulberry tree. This blind, flightless moth lays 500 eggs or more in just a few days and then dies. The eggs must be kept in strict environmental conditions. At first, they're kept at 65 degrees Fahrenheit, but the temperature must increase gradually to 77 degrees, at which point they hatch. From these eggs come 30,000 larvae, or worms, which eat a ton of mulberry leaves and produce 12 pounds of raw silk. Over thousands of years, the Chinese practiced sericulture using all the different kinds of silk moths known to them. But the Bombyx mori evolved into the specialized silk producer it is today, losing its ability to fly and only capable of mating and producing eggs for the next generation of silk producers. Producing silk is a lengthy process and demands constant close attention. To produce high quality silk, there are two conditions that must be fulfilled. One, perfecting the diet on which the silkworms feed, and two, preventing the adult moth from hatching from the cocoon. And the Chinese developed secret solutions to both. First, after the eggs hatch, the baby worms feed day and night, every half hour, on fresh, chopped mulberry leaves. These worms produce the finest, softest fibers called mulberry silk. Mulberry silk is very thin and lustrous. Thousands of feeding worms are kept on trays that are stacked on top of each other. Over a month, the worms will grow to 10,000 times their original weight. They will also shed their skin several times, changing color from dark to white. While they're growing, they're protected from loud noises, drafts, and strong odors. The silkworms feed until they have enough stored up energy to enter the cocoon stage. When it's time to build their cocoons, the worms produce a jelly-like substance in their silk glands, which hardens when it comes into contact with air. Silkworms spend 3 or 4 days spinning a cocoon around themselves until they look like puffy white balls. After 8 or 9 days, the cocoons are ready to be unwound and the silk harvested. To keep the mulberry silk in one continuous strand, the worms in the cocoons are subjected to heat before the adult moths are ready to break out of the cocoon. The cocoons are dipped into hot water to loosen the tightly woven silk filaments, and then the filaments are unwound onto a spool. A total of 5 to 8 of these superfine filaments are twisted together to make one silk thread. Finally, the silk threads are woven into cloth, plied into yarn, or used for embroidery thread. Today, China is the leading silk manufacturer in the world, producing 80% of the world's silk. Other sources include India, Japan, Korea, Thailand, Vietnam, Uzbekistan, and Brazil. Now let's talk about the characteristics of silk fabrics and yarn. Silk is composed mainly of protein because it's an animal fiber. It is a medium weight fiber, which is the only natural filament fiber in the world. And a filament just means that it's a long continuous strand of fiber. One cocoon is made of a single continuous strand of silk filament almost a mile long. Approximately 2,000 to 3,000 cocoons are required to make a pound of silk. This means that a skein of fingering weight yarn would take about 750 cocoons. As far as the properties of silk, it is very lustrous and has excellent drape. The reason it is so lustrous is that silk fibers are triangular. If you look at a silk filament under the microscope, it would look like a triangle. And this triangle acts like a prism, which refracts incoming light at different angles. So that's why silk yarn often looks very shimmery. Silk does not collect static electricity, and it does not pill because it's one long filament and doesn't have a bunch of fiber ends that stick out of the yarn, which is what causes pilling. Silk fabric can be hand washed or dry cleaned. Silk garments retain their shape and don't get stretched out. They have moderate resistance to wrinkling. Silk has good insulating properties, so it's definitely suitable for winter apparel. In fact, it's easy to find silk base layers like this one. This shirt is 100% silk and is made to be worn under your regular clothing in the winter. And that gives you an extra layer of warmth. You can see that it's very sheer, and you might think, how's that going to keep you warm? But that silk fiber does hold the warmth in around your body. The nice thing is that these garments are super thin and lightweight, so they don't feel bulky, yet they hold your body heat and keep you nice and toasty when the weather is cold. In addition to tops like this, you can also get long johns to wear under pants. Silk also has good moisture absorbency, which means that silk fabric is comfortable to wear in warm weather. Fabrics made from silk can absorb 11 to 30% of their weight in moisture, which is one reason why it's so easy to dye silk yarn. It just soaks that dye right up. Being absorbent also means that it soaks up perspiration, which will keep you cool in the summer. But be aware that perspiration weakens silk fibers and stains silk fabric. So silk garments really need to be washed or dry cleaned after every wearing. Now, along with all the desirable qualities of silk, it does have some unfavorable ones as well. Although it is a strong fiber, silk is considerably weaker when it's wet. It's also susceptible to sun damage as well as damage from clothes moths. Silk is relatively expensive to buy. If washed with strong alkaline soaps or chlorine bleach, it will turn yellow and the fibers will disintegrate. Silk also disintegrates over time simply by exposure to oxygen, which makes it challenging to preserve even in climate-controlled museum settings. Now, as far as yarns made out of silk, I have several examples here. The first one is a ball of Louisa Harding mulberry silk yarn. And oh, this ball is kind of falling apart because the yarn is so slippery. But this is nice and soft and lustrous. It's not super shiny like some silk yarns, but it has a more subtle sheen. It's a DK weight, 136 yards, and it was $14 per ball. Unfortunately, when I did an online search, it looks like this particular yarn has been discontinued, but you can still find it on eBay and Etsy. It makes beautiful tank tops, shawls, and I even made a lacy hat out of it. But the drawbacks to this yarn are that it's really slippery and it doesn't have any springiness or bounce. So that can make it a little more difficult to knit with. I would say use your bamboos or wood needles so the yarn gets a bit more grip than with the metal needles. And try to knit loosely, because if your stitches are super tight, you won't be able to get the needle through them because this yarn just doesn't give like when you knit with wool. Mostly the silk yarn that I have in my collection is some kind of a silk blend, like merino and silk together. I have a lot of merino silk yarn, and this is one example. This yarn is Plymouth Mulberry Merino, and it is 52% mulberry silk and 48% merino. I would say it's a worsted weight. It's very exquisite yarn, very loosely spun. So it has a very, so it's very soft and has that telltale silky sheen. Each skein is 99 yards and I paid $7.99 per skein. Unfortunately, this one is also discontinued, but honestly, there are tons of other yarns that are merino silk blends out there. Now, the nice thing about the merino silk blend is that the merino gives the yarn some elasticity, which makes it a lot easier to work with, in my opinion. Plus, it's not quite as slick as pure silk yarn, although I would probably still use wood or bamboo needles for it. I've always thought about making some kind of a lacy shawl out of this, something for a special occasion like a wedding or an elegant party. I just think that would be beautiful. Another example of silk and wool yarn is this one from Harrisville Designs. And this one is 50% silk and 50% wool. And each skein has 175 yards of DK weight yarn. I paid $7.80 per skein for this. And what I think is interesting about this yarn is that it has a matte finish, which is quite unusual for yarn with a lot of silk in it. Normally you can tell that a yarn has silk because of the shine, but this one doesn't have that at all. It's still soft to the touch and pleasant, but it is not slippery and lustrous like most silk yarns. And this is called a pebbly silk, and you can see that it does have some texture to it, some little nubs. Something like this would make a nice lightweight sweater, t-shirt, or a tank. Now, this is a shawl that I made out of a silk blend yarn a few years ago. This yarn is Scassell Urban Silk, which is 80% silk and 20% cotton. It's worsted weight and was just beautiful to work with. This is my favorite shawl that I've ever made. The pattern is Summer Flies by Donna Griffin, and I love this pattern. You can get it on Ravelry for $6. The shawl has sections of different lace motifs, so it's a fun knit that is fast and keeps your attention. It does have a picot bind off or picot edging, which takes a long time to do, but I absolutely love the look of it. So you might be able to tell on this shawl that the yarn has a pretty sheen. It is super soft, and you can also see that the yarn has a thick and thin quality, which I think adds to the attractiveness of the shawl. Here and there you can see some nubs, but I really like the overall appearance of this shawl. Besides mulberry silk, there are other types of silk whose qualities are largely determined by the type of trees the silkworms feed on. One example of this is tussah silk, which is less cultivated than mulberry silk. Tussah silkworms are allowed to feed on the leaves of trees like oak, juniper, and cherry. As the worms are not grown in a controlled environment, the moths hatch from the cocoons and interrupt the silk filament length, resulting in short and more coarse fibers instead of long and lustrous ones. The silk fiber that's produced is tan or brown and less lustrous than mulberry silk, and it is used for heavier textured fabrics. Another example is muga silk. Muga silkworms feed on the leaves of trees that are found in only one small region of India. The resulting silk is gold in color and highly prized. In this picture, you can see the gold muga silk cocoon on the right and the white mulberry silk cocoon on the left. Because it's only cultivated in a small geographic area, muga silk is the rarest form of silk and is very expensive. Now, sometimes two silkworms will nest together and form one cocoon made on a double strand of silk. The fibers are not separated, and the resulting yarn is called dupion silk. Dupion silk is a strong double thread silk, usually resulting in a rougher yarn and an uneven consistency. Fabric woven with dupion silk has telltale nups and slubs, which occasionally appear in the fabric. Removing these would both weaken the fabric and destroy part of its beauty and character. They are inherent to Dupian silk fabric and are not caused by defects in weaving. Now, I have several little hanks of Dupian silk yarn that I bought from a vendor on Etsy. I got it from Alice in Stitches Arts, and here's her Etsy shop. This yarn is very soft, smooth, and delicate with a nice silky luster. It's extremely slippery and kind of hard to keep in hanks. In fact, when they arrive, they are in these little cellophane packages to contain them. I mean, I can see this becoming a big mess if you're not careful to keep it untangled. And luckily, this is tied off in a few places around the hank, or it probably would have been tangled already. Now, this yarn is a 7-ply 100% mulberry Dupian silk. As you can see, it's spun very uniformly, so it doesn't have the slubs that you often see in fabric woven from Dupian. Or if they're there, they are very tiny. Each skein has 150 yards, and it's light sport weight, but it really looks like fingering weight to me. This is beautiful yarn, and it will drape exceptionally well. And because it's so slippery, again, you might want to use wood or bamboo needles, so the yarn doesn't just slide right off your needles if they're metal. Okay, so today we've learned about the history of silk making, the secrets of cultivating silk, the characteristics of silk, and we've looked at a few examples of silk and silk blend yarns. I hope you've enjoyed hearing about the fiber that is commonly considered to be the queen of all textiles. Well, that brings us to the end of today's show about silk. So what are your experiences with silk? Have you ever knit with silk or silk blend yarn? How did you like it? And what'd you make? Were any of the types of silk I talked about today new to you? Like mulberry silk, tussa, muga, or dupian? Yeah, let me know what you learned today, as well as your experience with silk textiles. Share your thoughts in the comment section below. Of course, please leave a comment if you have any questions about today's show, or if you have an idea for what you'd like to see on future episodes, or if you'd like to see a product tested. Leave your suggestions in the comment section below. I always love to hear from you. Thank you so much for spending some time with me today, and I'll see you in the next video. Next week, I'm thinking about doing a little demonstration on how to make really nice woven baskets out of yarn. I think you might be interested in this easy and quick project that can use up some leftover yarn you might have laying around. So I hope you'll join me for that next time. Oh, and one more thing before I go, next week's video will likely be a little late because I am going out of town for a few days this week at that research conference I was telling you about. And I may be able to get a video recorded, but in case I don't, or I don't have time to finish editing and everything before Monday morning, just know that it will be posted on YouTube sometime next week. Okay, so take care, everybody, and have a sparkly week.